Good evening, everyone. So today I'll be presenting a case on larynx. Presenting my patient, 50-year-old male. He's a farmer by occupation. He's coming from Jharkhand. He presented with the chief complaints of voice change since the past 5 months. Patient was apparently normal 5 months back when he developed hoarseness, which was progressive and initially started with the rough voice, which later progressed and attained the present state. According to the patient actually says the voice actually worsened for the last 2 months. In the last 2 months, there is no history of any difficulty in swallowing. There is no any history of painful swallowing or referred pain.
Nityanand, just before you proceed, let me just tell to the panelists that they can, you know, stop at any point during the presentation to ask any questions or start a discussion as you're presenting. So, panelists, Pai sir, Saurabh, Swagnik. Please feel free to stop him at any point that you feel you should start a discussion on some particular question topic based on the presentation.
Aurav and Swagnik, please take the lead.
Yes,
you need to ask questions to clarify any points as in any examination.
Swagnik, if you can just keep your video on, it will be useful for the audience to, you know, have a look at you. Yeah, great. And Saurabh also can please take the lead. Yes. Carry on, Nityanand.
The history of occasional cough while swallowing liquids and patient complaints of difficulty in breathing for the last two months, mainly after exertion. And he typically explains as noisy breathing during exertion. There is no labored breathing at rest. There is no history of any neck swelling. There is no history of any cough with hemoptysis. And there is no history of loss of weight.
Nityanand,
yes, sir.
From the present history, so initially the patient has given history, and whether the history was given by himself, okay, you have heard his voice. So, what was your initial impression about the patient?
Sir, based on the complaints he's saying about, I was making a point that the patient had some laryngeal pathology,
okay,
and which was progressive in nature, and when he complains of breathing difficulty, I suspect some lesion which is slowly occluding his airway also.
Okay, so something laryngeal pathology.
Yes, sir.
Now, and from the history.
Yes, sir.
Please, Saurabh, sir, please.
No. Please ask. Saknik, ask.
From the history, can you get some idea which subside of the larynx is likely to be affected?
Yeah, since his complaint started from as hoarseness, so probably this could be a lesion arising from the glottis, and which was gradually progressing and going to occlude his airway. So I'm expecting some glottis pathology.
Great.
Sir?
Yeah, so as you proceed, I mean, I'll just keep, putting across relevant questions across to you and the panelists. So there's one question that has just popped up. So Nityanand, I'll direct the question to you as to why it can't be a thyroid pathology, because you're saying just a change in voice and subsequently, obstructing his airway. So the question is, why not a thyroid pathology?
Sir, if at all it's a thyroid pathology, by the time the patient is having this voice change, initially it would have presented with the neck swelling, which would have been more obvious anteriorly than it spreading to the trachea or the larynx, sir.
And also there will be some swelling in the neck, which the patient would have said as well.
Yes. So coming to the past history, there is no history of any diabetes mellitus, hypertension, ischemic heart disease, tuberculosis, and any other comorbidities. Coming to the personal history, patient smokes BD for the past 20 years. He smokes one pack per day, that is 20 per day, and stopped for the last 3 months. And he does not consume alcohol.
One question, Nityanand.
Yes, sir.
Why history of tobacco you have taken? What is the relevance in this case?
So since the patient is complaining of voice change and he's like almost 60 years of age, in an old age, I would expect a malignancy, and this tobacco history is very significant in case if he's having a malignancy larynx, sir. And this tobacco history, like smoking, is known to has a patient who are smoking have higher chances of laryngeal malignancy.
And means is there any means what is the increased risk of smoking with laryngeal cancer? Do you have means?
Yes, sir. So based on Hishibe et al. So based on the as the pack years keeps increasing, the odds ratio of the malignancy also adds up. So if the pack years are less than 20, usually it is around 1.5 to 2, the odds ratio of cancer larynx developing. Or if it is more than 20 pack years, it increases more, odds ratio increases further more than to 3 or 4. And if it is synergistic with this alcohol history, so the odds ratio will increase more than 3 and up to, it can go up to 15.
And in India, what is the most common tobacco consumption habit?
So in India, as far as India concerned, Indian population mostly used smokeless tobacco.
Is there any association of smokeless tobacco and laryngeal cancer?
Yes, sir. There is one paper from India only. So there is a higher chances of hypopharyngeal malignancies being associated with the smokeless tobacco.
So there is no association. There is one paper which clearly says that there is no association with laryngeal cancer, but there is association with
hypopharyngeal. One important point, Nityanand, in the history part, did you take a history about symptoms of aspiration? And how is that important relevant in this specific case?
Yes, sir. I've explained about that cough while swallowing liquids was occasionally present. So that is to tell us whether the patient is actually aspirating or not, to get an idea of whether this larynx is functional or not, whether the functionality is preserved by the malignancy or if you're dealing with such a patient.
Great.
So coming to my general examination, my patient is conscious, cooperative, and averagely built and nourished. His BMI was 22. His vitals were stable, and there was no stridor at rest, and he was comfortable at rest. Patient had no pallor. On local examination,
just 1 minute, Nityanand. Here means you have written everything, and means don't you think something else specifically given would have been better as a general condition? So, like any scale.
Yeah. How do you assess the functional status of a patient using some defined scales?
So Karnofsky's performance status or WHO performance status could have been mentioned, sir. So according to that, my patient will be around grade 0 or 1, sir.
Grade 0 of which scale?
Yes, sir.
Grade 0 of which scale?
WHO, sir.
The ECOG.
Name the scale, ECOG.
And in Karnofsky?
Sir, Karnofsky will be around 9200.
Okay. Yeah, and why is it important to know about the performance status?
Sir, that will actually help us deciding the management for the patient, sir. In the case of when the performance status is poor, the patient may not be a very good candidate for tolerating radical management with CTRT or in conservative laryngeal procedures, where his pulmonary function and general condition of patient is very important for deciding this.
Right. Go ahead.
Coming to the local examination, patient mouth opening was adequate. There was no loose tooth present. Oral cavity and oropharyngeal examination was seems to be normal.
Why means examining loose tooth in a case of laryngeal cancer is important?
If I'm planning for a DL scopy, sir, I need to make sure there is no any loose tooth so that while putting the scope or when manipulating in the oral cavity, this loose tooth doesn't get slipped into the airway, sir.
Okay, go on.
I've done an FOL for this patient, fibrotic laryngoscopy of the patient. So I had found an infiltrative or a submucosal lesion arising from the right false vocal cord and true vocal cord, extending laterally into the right aryepiglottic fold, extending into the medial wall of the right side piriform fossa. The lateral wall of the piriform fossa was appearing normal. Posteriorly, the lesion was reaching up to the arytenoids, but the retroarytenoids was appearing normal only. Left side piriform fossa and posterior pharyngeal was appearing normal, and the light hemilarynx was appearing fixed. Base of tongue and valicula were free. I'll just this is the FOL picture of my patient. Sorry, it is like a little bit turned towards one side. So this was at the right side. This was the left side. We can see this submucosal lesion seems to be arising from the false vocal cord and the true vocal cord, and tend to be going going into the medial wall of the right PFS. Left side vocal cord seems to be mobile. Right side hemilarynx is completely fixed, and the base of tongue and valicula is appearing free.
So you have written that in the history that infiltrative lesion.
Yes, sir. Right? Yes, sir.
So where is infiltration? I'm just saying a swelling there. Means is there any infiltrative means there is a deeply penetrating.
Sir, the lesion is fully submucosal.
Submucosal bulge.
Yes, sir. I could see a submucosal bulge, sir.
But yeah, okay.
So what point now Zero was trying to make Nithyanand is that
yes,
you need to run, so it is a submucosal swelling.
When yes,
you
sir.
Say it is infiltrative, you will be able to actually see a spread. In this case, you're not seeing a spread, you're just seeing a submucosal growth.
Yes,
you don't need to mention infiltrative in this case.
Okay, sir. Coming to the neck examination, there is no difficulty in neck extension. There is an ill-defined swelling on the right side over the thyroid cartilage, which was moving with deglutition, and swelling is ill-defined, as I said, and it's approximately 2.5 × 2 cm. It was extending 1 cm from the thyroid notch, just close to the midline, towards on the right side, whereas the thyroid cartilage is appearing splayed. Laryngeal crepitus is present, and there is no thyroid swelling and no other neck nodes palpable. So this was my patient.
What is laryngeal crepitus?
Sir, I had tried to hold the larynx framework and try to move along the prevertebral fascia, sir, prevertebral muscles.
And what will you get?
So I would get, normally in the patients, I would get an crepitus feeling when I'm moving the laryngeal framework over the prevertebral muscles, sir.
And
that denotes,
will it be absent?
That denotes when any malignancy is not reaching the postcrecoid region, or any retropharyngeal pathology, sir.
Post-crecoid
caused by? What is the crepitus caused by? When you say laryngeal framework, it's a very ambiguous statement.
So it is crepitus is due to the movement of the cricoid over the prevertebral muscles.
Cricoid over the vertebrae, right? And what does it signify?
There is no pathology just behind the cricoid, sir.
What is just
behind? Yeah.
So post-cricoid region, sir, typically.
So post-cricoid region, you will not feel a crepitus?
Sorry, sir?
If you have a post-cricoid growth, your crepitus will be lost?
Yes, sir.
And what happens in the posterior pharyngeal wall going into the prevertebral fascia?
Even in those cases, it will be lost.
So, what is it indicative of? When you say laryngeal crepitus is present, what does it indicate? Does it indicate that there is no postcricoid growth, or does it indicate that there is no prevertebral involvement?
There is no prevertebral involvement, sir.
That is technically correct. When you can rub the cricoid versus the vertebra, it indicates there is no prevertebral involvement, not post-cricoid. Please correct that statement. You have to specify that you are seeing a proper neck extension and the laryngeal crepitus is present. That means there is no prevertebral involvement. That's it.
Okay, sir.
Go ahead.
So this is my patient examined under the neck extension. I could see a ill-defined swelling here, 2.5 centimeters lesion. So I would like to proceed with an contrast and CT scan of neck and thorax.
If I just may interrupt here, Nityanand, you're not given your possible diagnosis or any stage as of now, till now, and then you can proceed to your further management. Would the panelist agree with that?
Yeah.
Yeah. So before you go to the further management, Nityanand, we need to zero down on the possible diagnosis and the staging, if at all.
Okay, sir. So my possible diagnosis is I would be dealing with the case of malignancy of carcinoma glottis stage T4A, CT4A, N0, M0.
Why it is glottis? Why not supraglottis? Because it was means false cord and...
Yeah, since it was starting from the history was of hoarseness and later progressed, so I could just point it down towards glottis pathology.
One question, Nityanand. Is you have never mentioned about a DL scopy. So which cases you would like to do a fiber optic laryngoscopy and which cases you would like to do a DL scopy, and what are the differences you get if in these two examinations? I mean, how does one score over the other?
So one is DL scopy, other one, what did you say, sir? I'm not able to hear.
FOL, FOL.
Fiber optic laryngoscopy.
You have mentioned FOL.
Okay, FOL, yes. Yeah. So DL scopy is just to confirm once again your mapping, which is already mapped the disease, and typically it can tell about certain hidden areas which are missed in the FOL, like the post-cagoid region and the piriform fossa apex, and in sometimes that subclottis also can be viewed better in a DL scopy over an FOL, sir. So in a hypopharyngeal malignancy or in a supraglottic malignancy which is going toward the piriform apex, or if I suspect a spread into the post-cagoid region, then I would consider for a DL scopy. Otherwise, for general...
Now for this patient, yeah. Now for this patient with the infiltrative growth, which is not very well visible, would you like to see the ipsilateral piriform sinus, the apex and the cricopharynx, the post-cricoid?
Yes, sir. Sir, I would do a DL scopy to confirm the disease extent from my, which was initially seen in the FOL, mainly to look for the apex of the piriform fossa and the post-cricoid region.
And one more thing.
And the cricopharynx, yeah.
And for your, for any supraglottic, which is extending to supraglottic, though in this case, this is a less chance. So doing a DL scopy is always better to look for the pellicular region as well. Right?
Yes, sir.
Now let us just figure out, Nityanand, what should be the sequence? Should you first do a imaging or then and then do a DL scopy, or should you do a DL scopy first and then an imaging?
The sequence should be first DL, I mean first is imaging, CECT, then followed by a DL scopy, sir.
So why CECT? I mean CECT, it should be always CECT.
Sir, any imaging, preferably for a CECT. This case, as in this case, I'm suspecting an advanced laryngeal pathology where I suspect an extra laryngeal spread also. So I want to look for a laryngeal cartilage involvement, or I mean thyroid cartilage involvement or extra laryngeal spread also, in which a CT scan is highly specific over an MRI. So I would like to do a CT scan of the neck, and since it's an advanced lesion of stage 4, I want to look for any distant metastasis also. So I like to cover up the thorax also and do a CT scan neck and thorax contrast.
So just as a lot of other examining or other students are also listening to you, just explain clearly what are the advantages of CT and what are the advantages of MRI in this scenario. Which one gives better, tell about CT and both MRI for larynx.
Yes, sir. So, if you're dealing with an advanced laryngeal cancer, so to look for a cartilage erosion, so CT scan is highly specific, whereas an MRI is highly sensitive. That was the main advantage of doing the CT scan. Also, you can look for the extra laryngeal spread through the cricothyroid membrane or the thyroid?
For exolaryngeal spread through picothyroid membrane, which one will be better, CT or MR?
You can tell whatever you feel is right. You don't have to.
Sir, I feel both can give this a similar picture, sir.
What do you do in routine practice? And why do you do that? You just think like that and answer.
Routinely, we do CECT neck and thorax only, sir. And if at all we are suspecting a cricothyroid spread also, so we can get a clear picture in CT scan also, sir.
When do you want to do, so you said routinely you do a CT scan, right?
Yes, sir.
Is there any specific situation where you
So in case if you are dealing MRI. With an early, when you are doing with the early laryngeal malignancy, which is coming up to the anterior commission and is coming close to the thyroid cartilage or any cartilage, if you want to look for an early early cartilage involvement, MRI would be preferably better over it. Secondly, the second indication when you prefer MRI over CT scan is when you are having a prevertebral fascia, suspect prevertebral fascia involvement. In those cases, you prefer MRI over CT scan.
What is the thickness that you can get with a CT scan in comparison to an MRI? What slice thickness?
Sir, in a high resolution CT scan, you can get up to 0.6 millimeter of thickness. In a MRI, you can get the slice thickness up to 4 millimeter.
And
better resolution when we are trying to evaluate with a CT scan.
Sorry, sir.
Or in what, we get better resolution for the structures with a smaller slice thickness. So when you are evaluating glottic cancers, specifically early glottic cancers, which are going into intermediate advanced, you would like to rule out whether there is involvement of certain structures such as paraglottis, the anterior commissure, the arytenoid, the pre-arytenoid joint. And in those cases, CT scan scores over the MRI. And that is the reason we would like to do a CT scan. And specifically, we would like a high resolution CT scan. The current CT scanners are all multi-detector CT scanners. And with that, we can get very good resolution. So though, as Shiva rightly said, there are very limited indications for doing an MRI today because most of your evaluation is complete with a CT scan.
So, and the other advantage of doing a CT scan is that you evaluate both for local staging as well as rule out distant metastasis with a single investigation. So if you do an MRI, you need to do an additional investigation. So CT would be preferable. And in case you have a doubt as what was being discussed, you might add this, add over this an MRI.
Right.
Oh,
coming back on the CT scan.
Apart from
what else do you see on your CT scan? You said distant metastasis and that's why you're doing a CT thorax.
Yes, sir.
What else you'd like to rule out?
The nodal spread, regional spread also I want to look for, sir.
That you've seen anyway. Is there any role for seeing for second primary cancers and what is the indication in this case?
So second primary lesions are common more with hypopharyngeal malignancies
and in glottic, where are they common?
Sorry, sir?
What are the sites for second primary cancer in glottic cancers?
Sir, in a glottic cancer per se, the chances of second primaries are very low, sir. But if it happens, it can happen more in the lungs, sir.
And in hypopharyngeal cancer, where
it happens in the esophagus.
And when will you do 8CT? What are the indication of 8CT in laryngeal cancer?
Sir, if at all you are suspecting distant metastasis, most of the distant metastasis are located in the lungs only, sir. We can easily pick up those lung metastasis by doing a CCT neck and thorax itself. There is no advantage for doing metastatic workup by doing a PET because the chance of extra pulmonary distant metastasis are very, very low as far as head neck cancers are concerned. So if at all I'm doing a CC with neck and thorax, I'll be able to cover most of my distant metastasis which occurs in the lungs.
Okay,
go ahead.
Nityanand, I have one question. So is there any particular subsite where you would do more than just a CT thorax or slightly extend the CT cuts? I mean, of course, you would do a PET in case, you know, unable to do a PET or someone is unable to do a PET scan. We just have a facility for a CECT neck thorax.
Okay, sir. Then I would like to cover that abdomen also to look for the liver metastasis.
And more so in a CA hypopharynx because just want to scan the liver there, which is the next common site of distant metastasis, and that would complete your metastatic workup more or less.
Okay, sir. So I'll just put my CT scan pictures.
So there were some questions in the chat box. If the panelists agree, I can just, you know, a couple of questions can be asked right now. Yeah. So Nityanand, you had, before you play the CT scan, if you can just pause it there, I think one question that was asked was, why did you say T4 clinically? And the other, one of the participants wanted to know, when to use a Hopkins, rigid endoscope for examination of the larynx. So if you want to take the second question first, and then we can go to why it is T4.
So routinely in OPD, we start with an Hopkins examination, but during this COVID pandemic, we had avoided this Hopkins endoscopy, and that's why the FOL scopy under precaution, it was done. Right. And secondly, what's the question?
T4
because patient had clinically ill-defined swelling over the laryngeal frame, just above the laryngeal just over the thyroid cartilage, he had the ill-defined swelling. So that was moving with degradation also. So I suspect that was a lesion which is coming from the primary itself, coming out of the thyroid cartilage. So that's why I had graded as T4, so stage 4.
Meaning to say extra laryngeal spread.
Yes, sir.
You're suspecting that based on that. So these are the two reasons. Okay, yes, fine.
So this is my CT scan, contrast enhanced CT scan, axial images. So I'll be running from craniocaudally. This is at the mandible and this is at the epiglottis. I'm playing a CT scan. So here we can see the hyoid and beginning to see the pre-epiglottic space. So we are now beginning to see the lesion which is contrast enhancing here, which is involving the lower part of the pre-epiglottic space.
So especially for these, when the disease is going to pre-epiglottic space, also means you should do DL scopy to palpate the base tongue as well.
Let's finish the CT first. Let's go to the CT scan.
So this was an contrast and heterogeneously enhancing lesion, which is present in the supraglottis now. And it seems to be coming out of the extra laryngeal and has having some thyroid cartilage erosion also, and minimal subglottic spread also is there. I'll play the CT scan again. So this is the lesion. It's now involving the supraglottis and going down. This is at the vocal cord and now in the subglottis now.
Yes, sir. You're asking something?
Oh, no, just I was telling that it was going to be epiglottic space. Moreover, we were discussing now where to do the FOL and DL
right,
scoping.
Right.
So better to palpate always to the follicular.
So my question to Nityanand is, when you're reading the scan now, would you like to clarify what is the site and epicenter of the lesion?
Based on the CT scan, it is looking like the main bulk of the tumor is there present in the supraglottis, mainly at the false vocal cord level, and then going a little bit laterally to involve the thyroid cartilage and going eroding the thyroid cartilage and a minimal spread into the subglottis also.
Right.
So now, if I
That's what I'm talking
if about. Now, if I argue with you that this is developing from the medial wall of piriform sinus and then involving the larynx, this growth is originating from the medial wall of the PFS or the AE folds, and then it is going into the glottis and the subglottis.
But this typically maybe from the marginal zone, which is typically having this almost more or less similar picture in compared to supraglottis and the piriform fossa lesions. They will typically present at that area, and it will be like very confluent. We won't be able to clear cutly pinpoint which is the exact site of origin.
Right.
Yeah. So, yeah, exactly.
So what are the means clinically also? What are the means points you can say that probably it is from glottis rather than it's from PFS? What are the clinical findings which is more likely to have? One you pointed out.
So history-wise, the patient have hoarseness, sir. So that denotes the hoarseness was at least like 5 months of onset. So probably it is a glottis site's origin. In a supraglottic lesion or a piriform fossa lesion, the patient will typically complain of like foreign body sensation, which has progressed into difficulty in swallowing.
And second, also there is no neck nodes.
Okay. So now, how will you proceed?
So after getting this CT scan picture, I will plan for a DL scopy and a short GA. Then I would do a biopsy, take a biopsy from this lesion, and once my biopsy report is confirmed, then
I have a question here. When you were planning DL scopy for this patient, what precaution would you take?
Since the lesion is little bit coming very close to the airway, I would get a consent for an emergency tracheostomy during this procedure, and proceed with DL scopy, sir.
So the most important thing is the patient.
Not emergency. It's elective tracheostomy.
Elective tracheostomy. Yes. Okay.
So you don't want to wait for the emergency to occur. But sir's trying to say is that. But the most important thing is in such a patient where you're seeing the scan with an airway being, you know, almost 50% compromised, you want to evaluate whether the patient is having a borderline airway or not. Even if the patient doesn't have, you need to be careful. Talk to the patient and counsel for, you know, an elective tracheostomy, and then go ahead with your DL scopy and biopsy. You don't want to convert it into an emergency tracheostomy. That's exactly the point.
Yes.
One important point I wanted to make. For example, you are going ahead with a DL scopy and you are not done elective tracheostomy, and during the procedure the patient desaturating. Then how will you manage the patient in the OR? You plan and you immediately ask for a tracheostomy, but in the meantime, his saturation is coming down. Would you do some intervention with your DL scope and try?
Sir, if I'm having the DL scopy and patient is having the desaturation, then I would put the endotracheal tube through my DL scopy itself and secure the airway. And once it's
for a tracheostomy.
And then plan for tracheostomy.
Yeah. Great, great.
So I would do a biopsy for this patient, sir. So if biopsy is malignancy, then since the patient is having pericardial erosion, he is clinically T4A. So I would counsel him for a total laryngectomy procedure. Total laryngectomy with
paracardial. One more question, Nithyanand. Would you like to do a high tracheostomy, low tracheostomy, or any specific site where you want to?
Yes, sir. So if I'm doing an emergency tracheostomy, I would do an high tracheostomy. Considering this patient would go on for a total laryngectomy, I would include that part of tracheostomy, the trachea also include in my tracheal lower cut, sir.
Excellent.
So as it is a T4 laryngeal cancer, you would counsel the patient for total laryngectomy. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Why? What is the evidence that T4? Before laryngeal cancer,
yes, sir.
Why you will not be able to give him CTRT?
So this patient is having a clear-cut thyroid cartilage erosion and having an extra laryngeal spread also. We have seen from the landmark trials, from the VA trial itself, in which 29% of patients were T4, and out of these patients, almost 56 patients were landed up in total laryngectomy due to low
risk. You were telling, what was the, means there was small number of patients with T4, not 56% were T4. 29% of the patient who didn't
yes, sir, 29
have T4,
were T4, out of the 29, 56% landed up in total laryngectomy, sir.
And among the rest?
But Nityanand,
yes,
how
sir.
Many of those patients in the VA trial, EORTC trial had this kind of disease that you're showing?
Sir, RTOG trial had very less number of patients, less than 10% of patients who had actually had this type of disease. And VA trial also, they had more in favor of an organ preservation protocol. So this patient is having a more bulkier and grossly extra laryngeal tumor.
Yes. And so none of these trials talk about this kind of T4 disease.
So again, as Shiva said, have they specified that they had cartilage destruction?
No, sir.
I'm sure they were low volume T4s with an exolaryngeal spread without laryngeal framework destruction. So you need to specify. When Saurav asked you, is this patient suitable for the organ preservation? You should specify that there is a heavy compromise, cartilage and framework destruction. The possibility of preservation of organ doesn't exist. So there is no role of a for an organ preservation protocol in this patient, right?
Even when you're talking of the VA trial, as per that VA trial, patients with fixed cords, exolaryngeal spread and T4 disease did badly as per local regional control is concerned in the non-surgical arm.
Exactly. There are almost 7 times more incidents and diamonds disease recurrence, and later on they found in T4 disease.
Right. So what are the other concerns you have when you are seeing such a large volume disease?
Since it's an Excel...
Are you aiming for cure in this patient?
Sir, this patient is having a very high volume disease, and it's an exolaryngeal spread also. And I would expect some paratracheal lymph node spread also. And
so my question is very clear: your intent cure or palliation?
Sir, my intent will be curative only, sir.
Okay. So what is the overall survival pattern in this group of patients?
Sir, overall survival will be upwards of 50%, sir, after total laryngectomy.
Only after total laryngectomy?
Total laryngectomy with adjuvant therapy, sir.
50%
What is the failure pattern in these patients following treatment?
So these patients tend to have 10% of local recurrences, and if it's a hypopharyngeal malignancy, there is high chance of distant metastasis.
So I would have preferred you to clarify what is the local, regional and distant metastasis in these patients. Recurrence, sorry. So please look up what is the local recurrence pattern, regional recurrence pattern and distant recurrence pattern.
Okay, sir.
Following total laryngectomy with postoperative radiation.
Okay, sir.
Nityanand.
Yes, sir.
In which scenario there is higher chances of level 6 central compartment involvement in laryngopharyngeal cancer?
So, if there is an post-record involvement, posterior pharyngeal wall involvement, there is a pre-existing tracheostomy, and if it's an exolaryngeal spread coming into the thyroid gland, then there's a chance of pre-tracheal
anything else?
Subglottic extension.
Subglottic extension.
Subglottic and apex of piriform fossa. There is involved, again, the chances are.
So can you please,
Will you do neck dissection in this case?
Yes, sir. Since it was an main bulk of disease in the supraglottis and it is like stage 4, I would do a neck decision in this case, sir. Bilateral, 2 to 4 I would cover, sir.
So, can you please mention the complete line of treatment?
So,
central compartment.
Sorry, sir. Central compartment also I would clear and it will be part of the specimen, sir. Main specimen.
In which side will you do?
Sorry, sir.
Part of the main specimen.
Will you do a bilateral or will you do central compartment?
Central compartment, I'll do bilateral, sir.
If you see NCCN guidelines, generally they suggest unilateral. Any laryngeal cancer in the main bulk disease. Okay.
Since this tumor is going completely extralaryngeal, so that's what I would prefer doing bilateral. So
can you just in one line delineate the exact extent of surgery in this patient?
So it will be total laryngectomy with bilateral neck dissection, 2 to 4. With TP.
What about the pharynx?
So based on the pharyngeal mucosa remnant, so I would consider for an primary closure on any reconstruction.
Not a question. It's total laryngectomy.
You pause whether it's going to be a laryngeal resection alone or it'll also include pyriform sinus.
So based on my DL scopy, I would make the decision, sir. But looking at the CT scan wise, it is mainly located in the supraglottis. And my pyriform fossa seems to be apex seems to be fine. So based on the CT scan, I would at least anticipate and primary closure in this case, sir.
Nithyanand,
what about the closure? We are trying to ask you whether you do a partial pharyngectomy or you're going to do only a total laryngectomy.
So it will be with the partial pharyngectomy also, sir.
Yes. So when Swagnik asked you what would be your surgery, would be total laryngectomy with partial pharyngectomy with bilateral neck dissection and central compartment.
With thyroidectomy, ipsilateral.
And Nityanand, what is your plan, Riga? How would you want to manage the thyroid in this patient, thyroid gland?
Sir, usually in a case when the unilateral involvement is there, we usually do a lobectomy. The usual chance of spread of tumor into the thyroid gland used to be around 9 to 13% expected in literature. So, I would usually do an...
What is the incidence reported in our institute?
Sir, 13%, sir.
Okay. Nithyanand, the cursor in that, go to the CT means at number 5, 4, 5. Do you think anything extra because... about the extension, which may your clinical examination and also the CT card.
So it is a little bit appearing close to the skin. So probably the skin also may be removed, sir.
If you have to remove the skin, then what will be your plan for reconstruction?
So if it is along with the skin, then I would consider for an looking at the skin is looking a little bit small in size only, sir. It could be a primary closure. If not, then I would do an ALT flap for this patient.
Now Nithyanand.
Yes, sir.
For this type of lesion, if you are primarily been able to close the mucosa, will ALT flap means will not be a overkill for this? Anything else?
PMC, sir.
Again, PMMC, you may have to use them later on if there is something recurrence or anything. But or it may become very bulky. Cannot you use just for the skin
flap? Yes, sir. So, facial cutaneous free flap like free radial forearm can be used, sir.
Just a deltopectoral flap, DP.
Nithyanand, a supraclavicular flap also can be used if you're not doing addressing level 5 on either side. That's the best thing to do.
Yeah.
For the external skin. And best in the sense, in my opinion, not as per literature.
I have the point first in Nithyanand. First, how do you decide on the skin excision, if at all, or the extent of skin excision for this patient, particular patient? I mean, what is your call on whether you will excise the skin or not?
So clinical examination, if the pinchability of the skin and during accession also, during flap elevation also, I want to see how close is the third dimension of the skin, like third dimension of the tumor to the skin, so that I want to see the distance from there. So based on that, I will take a call about how much skin to be excised, sir.
So Nityanand, so the statement that you're making, you have to be very careful because you have to plan your incision accordingly. If you have a doubt in your mind that the skin might go, then in that case, you need to plan your incision accordingly. You cannot raise your regular, you cannot use a routine incision for a laryngectomy and then decide on table that, yes, I'm going to remove this much of skin. Then that will be a problem. So if you anticipate that the skin needs to go, you need to plan your incision accordingly. So that's the point here. So you plan to need, you need to plan your incision and how would you reconstruct that defect that you're creating subsequently as well. So you need to keep these facts in your mind. Right. Yeah, proceed.
So, yeah.
Yes, Arni, please go ahead.
No, I had a question. Yeah, proceed, Nithyanand. We'll get into that later on.
Sir, I'm done, sir.
So how will you rehabilitate this patient for speech and swallowing?
So I would like to put a tracheosophageal, a primary tracheosophageal process I want to put for this patient, sir, for rehabilitating.
So what are your indications for putting primary versus secondary?
So as far now is concerned, primary can be done even for all cases per primum as well as in salvage setting. And the success rate of the TEP is over 90%.
So how will you select out your patient for putting a prosthesis today?
So it will be based on the reconstruction I'm planning. And during the surgery, if at all the...
Apart from that...
Party wall, the tracheosophageal party wall is not disrupted, then I would prefer that primary TEP.
What are the other selection criteria for TEP?
So for a TEP, the basic requirements will be like the patient should be having a good vision and dexterity to use the TEP, and minimal intelligence also. And the minimal and the still stoma size should be at least 1.5 centimeter to occlude it for the usage of TEP.
What else?
Good proper maintenance of the TEP patient should be well motivated, and he should be like okay to visit the hospital, the clinician for troubleshooting of the TEP.
And Nityanand, recently we didn't do a TEP for one patient because of a reason. If you can just recollect that.
Yes, sir. It was due to poor pulmonary function, due to COPD, it was not done, sir.
A good lung reserve is important as well for a proper functioning of a TEP that you would put.
Yes, sir.
And if you are doing TEP, then what extra thing you have to do during the surgery?
Sorry, sir?
And if you are planning to do TEP,
yes,
what
sir?
Else you will do during the surgery?
Not only TEP, it will help in swallowing also.
Cryopharyngeal myotomy, I would do it, sir. Sir, cryopharyngeal myotomy, I used to do.
Good.
Yeah. Now, Nityanand, next point, post-op, you have operated the patient post-op. How will you, what you will look in the daily rounds and what are the precautions you will take in the post-op period for these patients?
So during the post-op rounds, I would look for the stoma, and the stoma with the surrounding mucosa I would look for. And the initial post-op days, I would look for whether the skin crease is appearing or not. That would tell me whether the skin flap has properly stuck to my the sutured larynx or not. And then I would make sure there will be no crust and proper maintenance of the stoma with adequate cleaning, and the TEP should be properly cleaned with the brush, TEP brush, and I would also use a laryngeal bib to keep the stoma and the airway humidified.
Two
How
questions are coming
in. Sir?
Ask Sagni.
Madhav sir, please. I asked how will you
how will you
Saurabh sir please go on
Saurabh, no, two questions are coming in chat box actually Shiva is answering but I just thought that for benefit may not be everybody is seeing the chat box very important there but when will you close the pharynx primarily and when will you augment it with some flap that is one question it's coming and second is what when will you do means for to select a patient for near total laryngectomy what should be the criteria or for any larynx near total and also for means tell me about first near total
so first about I'll tell you about the reconstruction so if the primary reconstruction will be decided based on the DL scopy whether you need a patch reconstruction or it will be a primary closure or not and secondly you can decide the same thing once after the resection also is done so based on the general consensus by the paper by Hui et al so he has said that at least unstitched mucosa should be around 2.5 cm to be able to get to be able to close in a primary closure so or usually the clinician decide maybe he should be able to close the remnant pharyngeal mucosa over a 40 French Foley's 40 French Rydell's tube so if it is not possible then I would consider for a patch pharyngoplasty either augmented with an pedicle flap or a
2.5 cm sir? In the upper part do you think it is adequate in near valicula
no sir it is around the cricopharynx close to the cricopharynx only is 2.5 cm unstitched
then above it should be around 5 cm
yes
and
second about the near total laryngectomy near total laryngectomy is like a part of it's a radical procedure it is not actually a conservative laryngeal surgery
exactly.
So the
why it is not conservative what is the to be become a conservative laryngeal surgery what is the means here near total you are actually
so patients will actually be breathing with the tracheostomy per end stoma only
exactly
only thing they will have a natural shunt through which they can speak sir
yeah. Okay.
So for the patients for if I'm considering for an near total laryngectomy the patient the disease should be well lateralized at least one cricoarytenoid unit should be preserved which is including the recurrent laryngeal nerve and
and 2/3 of the vocal cord
sorry sir and contralateral vocal cord should be able to be at least like it should not be going more than 1/3 of the contralateral vocal cord sir.
And retroarytenoid
should be free sir
so now for
the retroarytenoid and interarytenoid
yes.
Yeah. Otherwise you have to
for this particular
interarytenoid is involved you have to take both arytenoid hai na
this particular patient would you think of doing an NTL
sir this patient is having a lesion which is coming close to the arytenoid so I want to make the decision during the primary excision also if I am not able to get a good margin with the interarytenoid region or retroarytenoid region after sacrificing that tipharyngeal arytenoid then I won't be able to do an NTL sir
Let's go to the complications. If you have a pharyngocutaneous fistula day 2 versus day 6, what will be your management? Will it change?
Sir, if it is an early pharyngocutaneous fistula, mostly the it's like due to a surgical technique failure only. And if it is a day 6 leak, it could be due to any the suture given away in the closure site. So my intent will be a little bit towards conservative management if I'm dealing on if I'm getting a leak on the 6th day while comparing the leak on the 2nd day sir.
So what will you do in on the day 2
day 2 I'll still have an look for the nature of the secretion I mean how much want to quantify the discharge and then take a call sir
What call?
whether to re-explore and resuture the defect.
So you, if you have a very early leak, like you said, if there's a technical issue of a technical failure, you would go ahead and explore and secure the fistula site, and if required, buttress it. If it is beyond 6 days, you would consider conservative management. So now that brings us to the question. We have been discussing about the pharyngeal reconstruction. What is the best form of pharyngeal reconstruction for a patch pharyngoplasty?
Sir, best form would be to replace the mucosa with an almost flap, which is almost about the same texture or same consistency of the mucosa itself. That would be a fascia cutaneous flap, sir. So I would, and it should be from a different far side usually, if I'm dealing with the salvage case and all. So the best flap would be based on the defect size, to decide about the defect size. Either it should be a fascia cutaneous in the form of a free radial forearm or an ALT flap, keeping the PMC as a, on a salvage setting or a second workhorse flap, you can keep it as. If all these are non-circumferential defects. If it is a circumferential defect, then based on the site of the anastomosis of the, whether the defect is appearing within the neck or going down the thorax, I would decide about whether doing a gastric pull-up versus free jejunum flap.
Nityanand, I have a question for you. Why do you keep PMMC third in your list and the other fascia cutaneous flap higher up? Is there a reason to that?
Sir, based on the literature, there are two reasons. One, this fascia cutaneous flap, like FRAF and ALT, they're less morbid. Second thing, the chance of pharyngeal fistula and the stenosis rate below the suture site are lower when compared to PMMC.
Why is it so, Nityanand? Because both you are using skin with mucosa. So both in ALT, radial forearm and PMMC. So how is it that radial and ALT score over PMMC in this case?
Sir, in PMMC we have to take along with the muscle, sir. So it's a more bulkier flap. And it the bulkiness of flap itself has 2-3 disadvantages. One is that it can fall over the stoma. And second thing, speaking of the functionality, this pharyngeal esophageal segment, which we are like reconstructing with the PMMC, it's not very good for TP wise reconstruction.
So that must be your first answer, Nityanand. There are literature and whatever systematic reviews that are there, which tells that when you use a fascia cutaneous flap in the form of ALT or a radial forearm flap, the voice production is better in comparison to the use of PMMC. And when you're using a fascia cutaneous flap for a circumferential defect is when your stricture rates come into picture. Whereas for a partial pharyngectomy, where you're using a fascia cutaneous flap, it's more of the voice production that takes precedence over the stricture formation. And there is literature available which supports the use of fascia cutaneous flap for a better voice outcome subsequently. Any other questions from the panelists?
Now, Nityanand, you have operated this patient. You have done a patch pharyngoplasty. And this patient, from the wards, the nursing staff calls you and they say there is bleeding from the surgical site. So how do you, what vessels do you suspect most commonly and how do you manage that?
So if it is
in the ward, what to, yeah, please go ahead.
Just before Nityanand answers this question, I just would like to remind the panelists that we are towards the last 5 minutes. And once he answers this question, I would request the panelists to give your marks or your assessment for Nityanand at the end of this answer. Thank you. Yeah, proceed, Nityanand.
So, sir, it was like just a bleed or it was patients having a PC fistula before, sir?
Nothing. Patient, the nursing staff calls you and in the second post-op day. and says that there is some bleeding from the neck sutures. What immediately you will do, and how will you proceed with this complication?
So based on the quantification of the bleeder, then if it was a very massive bleed, then I would suspect ligature which has slipped from the, since it's a post-op date, ligature slipped from the any superior thyroid or the inferior thyroid which were ligated, sir.
Great. That will be the problem. First thing that you will do, what you will do.
So I'll put back the tube. Patient. So I'll put back the tube and give compression over the neck, sir.
Great. Then you will take 2 hours.
Yes, sir.
Excellent.
So I'd request the panelists to give your assessment for Nityanand.